I welcome you all to this webinar on liver transplant, non-neoplastic and neoplastic considerations, a clinical pathological approach. Thank you all for joining us today. And we have with us Dr. Samyusha sir, Dr. Ravi Mohanka, Dr. Anuradha Murthy as our experts. Welcome, sir. Welcome, ma'am. The flow of today's webinar will be like a brief introduction of the topic. This will be followed by Dr. Samir Shah sir's talk. He'll be covering non-neoplastic considerations in the liver transplants. Dr. Ravi Mohanka sir will take us through the neoplastic considerations and recent advances in surgical approach. And then Dr. Anuradha Murthy will talk on the explants in hepatic neoplasms with emphasis on tumor and IHC markers. This will be followed by a question and answer session. So please type in your questions in the chat box and we shall address them in our panel discussion at the end of today's session. So we'll start with the introduction, brief introduction. So as you all know, liver is a very vital organ, means that one cannot live without liver. And liver transplantation involves replacement of the surgical replacement of the unhealthy liver with healthy one, and the graft is obtained from a cadaver or living donor. Though it sounds very easy when we say this, but in reality, it's a very complex procedure, and it is one of the most successful innovation in the medicine in past few decades, and it's been a life-saving procedure for many patients with chronic end-stage liver diseases and with HCC and also in cases of acute liver failure. And it's a multidisciplinary practice wherein all of us work together with the goal of providing the patient a thorough yet timely care, not only during the transplant, but also before and after the transplant. So we are actually fortunate as we have worked closely with the stalwarts in the field of transplant and have benefited by the clinical pathological correlation and continuous demand for improved patient care. So the main purpose of today's webinar is to share our understanding, our knowledge and our learning during this endeavor and what we have learned in the liver pathology in explant in transplants and its clinical correlation in terms of the management of the patient of the liver transplant. So today is an excellent opportunity for us as we'll be listening to the leaders in the field of transplant. So let me introduce today's speakers. Our first speaker is Dr. Samir Shah sir, and he'll be talking about transplants and non-neoplastic considerations. He's consultant and head of the department of hepatology in Global Hospital Mumbai and visiting consultant to Jaslok Hospital and Research Center and Breach Candy Hospital. He has been the driving force to coordinate efforts to start a cadaveric organ transplant program in the country and in Mumbai in particular. He is trained in hepatology and liver transplant at the Institute of Hepatology, University College London, and secretary of the Indian Association for Study of the Liver for period of 1995 to 97. He is Council member of International Liaison Committee, Asian Pacific Association for the Study of the Liver, member of the editorial board of the Indian Journal of Gastroenterology, National Advisory Board of the Journal of Association of Physicians of India, and Journal of Clinical and Experimental Hepatology, founder, trustee, and honorary secretary of the National Liver Foundation, and expert on core advisory group on viral hepatitis, ICMR. Our next speaker is Dr. Ravi Mohanka, sir. He'll be talking on the liver transplant non-neoplastic consideration, recent advances in surgical approach of liver transplant. So he's trained and worked, he's head of the department hepatobiliary and liver surgery global hospital and trained and worked at most reputed hospitals in India and US like prestigious Thomas Stahl's Transplantation Institute at the University of Pittsburgh, and trained in laparoscopic and robotic liver surgery in France and Italy. His areas of expertise in current practice include living donor and cadaveric liver transplant, hepatobiliary surgeries in adult and children, liver resections, perihilar cholangiocarcinoma, pancreatic, intestinal, and multivisceral transplants. And he has published more than 35 articles in international journals and 5 book chapters. Our third speaker is Dr. Anuradha Murthy, ma'am, and she'll be talking about the hepatic neoplasm with emphasis on tumor and ISC markers. She is a senior consultant at Metropolis with more than 30 years of experience. She has worked previously at HN Hospital, Imperial College of Medicine, Hammersmith Hospital, Jaslok, GSM, KM Hospital. And she, her special interest is in nephropathology, pediatric pathology, gastrointestinal pathology, and immunofluorescence for kidney diseases. She has numerous publications and presentations to her credit in national and international journals. So we'll start with our webinar and invite Dr. Samir Shah, sir, to give his talk. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. So if you can unshare your screen, then I can show your my slides.
Yeah. I'm unshare.
At the outset, let me thank the Metropolis for organizing this webinar. It is extremely crucial for everyone involved to understand where liver transplantation has come in today's day and age. And I think between three of us, we will sort of give you an overview of what has been happening recently. My task is to talk on non-neoplastic consideration. All of us realize that liver silently gets affected and does not show any signs till it may reach the end stage. So end stage liver disorder or disease can occur after increasing liver fibrosis, and the patient may stay in compensated state. But when he becomes decompensated, that may be the first time when the patient shows any complaints of ascites, pedal edema, GI bleeding, encephalopathy, or developing liver tumor, and may eventually die. Now, two things have happened which changes this natural history. One is we now have medications which can reverse the process, and we have liver transplantation, which can change the outcome if the patient cannot have any further medical benefit. So two things can be achieved now. Let's go through that. So when is liver transplantation required? Liver transplantation is required when you reach a stage of decompensation where you can no longer reverse the process and the patient cannot have a good fulfilled life with his own liver. It can be either a chronic liver disease, which has now failed and decompensated, or a patient may have a normal liver and suddenly acutely he may fail to have a normal liver function. So acute liver failure, or acute on chronic liver failure. So the chronic liver failure may be silent or known, and suddenly acutely this patient may develop liver failure and reach a stage where he may require a liver transplant. So these are the three situations. Either a patient who is known to have a chronic liver disease and then gradually deteriorates, the first one, decompensated liver disease, or a patient who does not have any known liver diseases, has a normal liver, and suddenly acutely the liver fails, or the patient may have been known or not known to have a chronic liver disease, but acutely it fails. These are the three situations where liver can fail. So most important thing is how to prognosticate. So these are the three important questions. Who will survive without transplantation is the most important thing to know in a patient who comes to you. The other important question is who will die unless transplanted. So if you don't have facilities of transplant, this patient is surely going to die. It is very important to identify these individuals. And third most important thing is that the patient has reached such a stage where he may die despite transplantation. So this is what is called futility. These are the three important questions which we need to answer to prognosticate. So for that, important thing which has developed over the years is liver intensive care. And we are fortunate to have a liver intensive care unit which is dedicated to liver patients. And here you can do specialized treatments called chronic renal replacement therapy, a continuous renal replacement therapy, CRRT, or plasmapheresis. These are the two things which act like a liver dialysis, and they give us breathing time and allow the liver either to recover completely or go to the next stage of a liver transplant. Again, two most important questions in liver transplant: deciding the right time of transplant, because if you are too early and transplant, you may have a patient who would have otherwise recovered on its own. That's not the correct thing to do. If you are too late, then even putting in a new liver is useless. So right time is important. And the right patient, whether the disease is such where you are going to help, like how in a patient with liver cancer, which is advanced and gone out of the liver, putting in a new liver is not really going to help. So these are important questions we need to answer. Let's see, deciding the right time. How do you decide whether it is the right time for you to consider liver transplant in a person who has got liver failure? So this is called MELD score, model for end stage liver disease. This is calculated by three very simple sort of tests which we routinely do. And the fourth one is added now, sodium. So creatinine, bilirubin, INR, and sodium. With that, you get a MELD score or MELD sodium score, and that predicts the 3-month mortality. So if you have a patient whose MELD score is less than or equal to 9, then these patient who may be hospitalized or patient who may be coming into your OPD has a very low chance of dying in the next 3 months. If you do a transplant, yes, you will change the liver, but then he would have survived on his own also for the next 3 months. However, as the MELD score goes more than 10 and it reaches more than 20, there is a chance of dying with that liver, and it is best then to replace the liver. So MELD score can very easily tell you whether this patient is going to benefit by a liver transplant or not. So this is how, if you have a patient with either child A, B, or C, or MELD less than 10 or more than 10, then as the MELD goes more than 10, or as the child becomes from A to B, that is the time when you should start sort of thinking about liver transplant and referring to a place where a transplant is possible and the patient can be evaluated, and then proceed for liver transplant evaluation. So that is about the right time, the MELD score. Second is the right patient. Now let us look at the indications of liver diseases and how, which indication would fit in with thinking about a liver transplant. The commonest causes of liver disease are hepatitis B and C. Hepatitis B, because of good antiviral agents, they have changed the scenario as far as liver failure because of hepatitis B is concerned. So number one, the virus may remain silent and not multiplying and not cause any liver disease. So all hepatitis B patients actually do not need any antiviral drugs also. We need to thoroughly assess and regularly follow up and see. Most important, the entire family needs to be screened. Hepatitis B can be now fully controlled. It cannot be cured. The virus may still be in the liver, but you can control it and the liver disease can be stabilized and the patient can go on with hepatitis B for a long time. However, if this patient suddenly develops acute liver failure or liver cancer, then hepatitis B is an indication where you may require a liver transplant. Let's come to hepatitis C. Hepatitis C has, over the last 20 years, completely changed now as far as these natural history is concerned, because we have good drugs now. So these are oral drugs which can cure hepatitis C. We never use cure very easily, but in hepatitis C, you can talk of cure because the virus is completely eradicated. So you can cure the hepatitis by a simple 12 to 24 weeks treatment regime. However, unfortunately, if the liver has already failed, then curing the virus may not help at that stage. Or if the patient has developed a liver cancer, these are the two situations where even though we have curative treatment for hepatitis C available, the patient may still require liver transplant. So you may put in a new liver, and then the hepatitis C which has remained, you can easily cure after the transplant. The next common problem is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. We have now realized that fatty liver is not benign, that fatty liver can go to the stage of steatohepatitis, what we call NASH. And this situation can further progress to fibrosis and cirrhosis, and the patient may develop either decompensated liver disease or the patient may develop liver cancer. Fatty liver disease can be reversed if you lose more than 10% of weight. Even the fibrosis can regress. So that is very important to realize. A lot of new drugs are being looked at to reverse the fibrosis and the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis which develops with fatty liver disease. All the medications which are there, which help control the metabolic syndrome, will control the progress of the NASH which is there in the liver, or you can directly target the liver and protect the liver. If the patient is morbidly obese, then a sleeve gastrectomy in that situation is known to reverse the fibrosis. However, if the patient has got clinically significant portal hypertension, then you cannot do these surgeries because the liver may fail. So liver transplant in fatty liver disease is important, because although fatty liver is common up to 30% of population, and not all fatty liver disease may go to progress, but it is important to identify which patient is at a risk of progression. Appropriate utilization of the lifestyle changes and metabolic control is the first step, and that can reverse the process. Antifibrotic drugs are still in clinical trials, but they are sure to come, which will again, as I said, reverse the process of NASH and fibrosis. However, unfortunately, those who have already progressed to decompensated liver disease, there you cannot help them, and they will need liver transplantation. Alcoholic liver disease. Alcoholic hepatitis is a condition where an alcoholic patient who continues to drink alcohol suddenly can develop liver failure. And it is realized that this patient, although he is so sick, if you transplant them, then they have the same type of response as a non-alcoholic liver disease patient would benefit from liver transplant. So liver transplantation can salvage the situation. So it's important to realize that severe alcoholic hepatitis has a poor prognosis. Abstinence and nutrition is still the mainstay of treatment. Most alcoholic liver disease patients would stabilize, but if they do not stabilize, then carefully selected, these patients will benefit from liver transplant. So we have considered hepatitis B, hepatitis C, we have considered fatty liver disease, and we have considered alcoholic liver disease. Hepatocellular carcinoma, my colleague Ravi Mohanka is going to handle. We have been fortunate to have established a center which is dedicated to liver care. We have a liver intensive care, we have a dedicated liver transplantation program, and we have done 440 liver transplantation. Interestingly, you will see that non-alcoholic fatty liver disease tops the list of indications. So it is not alcohol, but non-alcoholic fatty liver disease also can progress to liver failure and be an indication for liver transplantation. Hepatitis B and C are becoming less and less of a problem because we have effective drugs to take care. The other indications are these other etiologies of liver disease. The patient may present, as I said, in either in acute liver failure or acute on chronic liver failure, or with chronic liver disease which has decompensated, and we have been able to transplant all these patients with a good success rate. So liver transplant, non-neoplastic consideration, hepatitis B can be controlled and hepatitis C can be cured. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and alcoholic liver disease are both lifestyle disorders and are preventable. We need to prevent them. However, unfortunately, in some patients, if they have progressed to a stage where liver has failed, then liver transplant is established now as a treatment modality and can be life-saving. Early diagnosis, proper assessment, and correct guidance is the key if we need to have a good outcome in these patients who are otherwise destined to die with their liver failure. Thank you. So back to Megha.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful talk. Very nicely explained, sir. And a very complex topic still in a simplified manner, that too in such a short time. So now our next speaker is Dr. Ravi Mohanka, sir, and I request him to please start the session.
Sure. Thank you very much, Megha. After that nice talk by Dr. Samir Shah, it sets the stage for me to discuss the other in common indication for liver transplant, which is cancer. So liver is the only organ that can be used for treatment of a cancer. There is no other organ transplant which is used for treatment of a cancer of that organ. And as we know, there are several types of tumors in the liver, including primary tumors such as HCC and cholangiocarcinoma, and secondary tumors from different parts of the body. But the main indication for liver transplant is for hepatocellular carcinoma or HCC. And that is what we are going to discuss today. The other types of cancers have very limited role for liver transplant, and therefore at this point they are not mainstream. So we'll restrict our discussion to liver transplant for HCC. So one of the main things we have realized over all these years is that liver transplant is a curative treatment for HCC. Now, this is not something that we can say easily for a lot of diseases, because there is, whenever you treat cancer, there is always a risk of recurrence of the tumor in the future. But here, because we are not only treating the tumor, but we are also treating the underlying liver cirrhosis, therefore it is considered curative for HCC. Now, before we embark on any treatment for a patient with HCC, there are certain things that we do as a for evaluation of not just the tumor, but also the patient's liver disease and also the patient's performance status. Because all these three things will together decide what treatment we are going to offer to the patient. So the most one of the most common things we do is a triphasic CT scan or a MRI of the abdomen of the liver, and either a MRE, which is a magnetic resonance elastography, or a fibroscan. Now these will tell you whether the liver is smooth or nodular, so whether there is cirrhosis or not. And then what is the stiffness of the liver? So this will also tell you if it is fibrotic or if it is cirrhotic. Then we will we'll do a HRCT, high resolution CT or bone scan to evaluate for spread of the tumor. Or alternatively, we can use a whole body PET scan, but it is more common for a lot of centers use the HRCT of bone chest for assessment of metastatic disease. Then there are tumor markers that we are familiar with, which is AFP and PIVCA2. There are other tumor markers also that have been studied, like AFP, L3 subunit, but they're not in common use. These are the two that are in more common use. Then we'll do an upper GI endoscopy, and if that is showing varices, then we know that there is portal hypertension. But if it does not show varices, then we may do a hepatic vein pressure gradient, HVPG, which will tell us about the portal pressure in this patient. And then sometimes we do a ICG clearance, which is endocyanin green clearance, which will tell us the retention of this dye, which is exclusively excreted by the liver. How much of it is retained by the liver? That will tell us about the functional status of the liver. Now, one of the main things that you'll notice here is a biopsy which is missing. Now, this is very important that we do not normally do a biopsy for diagnosis of HCC. There are two reasons. One is that we have excellent imaging, that is a triple phase CT scan or a triple phase MRI can give us a very definite or a very confident diagnosis of the tumor, and therefore a biopsy is not required. Secondly, in the past, when we used to do biopsy for such tumors, we realized that there was about 1.5 to 2% risk of the tumor spreading or tumor seeding with the biopsy itself. And therefore, that's another reason why we don't do it anymore. Now, when there is a patient who has liver cancer or HCC, depending on the three factors, which is the patient's tumor, the patient's liver disease, and the patient's performance status, we have an algorithm which is quite commonly used. It was published by the Barcelona group. And there are various treatment options from resection to transplant to all types of loco-regional treatments to all types of systemic treatments which are possible for a patient who has HCC. But our focus today is going to be discussion of about transplant. So when we started doing surgeries for or surgical treatments for patients with liver cancer, we realized that we are not actually solving the problem. We are temporarily postponing the problem, because what used to happen was we used to get about 60 to 90% to 95% recurrence in a matter of 5 years. So that was very suboptimal. And therefore, we realized that probably a surgical treatment of liver tumor is probably not the right way to go. And the reason could be because there were probably underlying tumors that were undetected by the imaging, that were growing in the future within 5 years and showing up, or because the liver was cirrhotic, there were newer tumors, de novo tumors, which were coming up. And therefore, we realized that resection was not really a very good, it wasn't giving us very good results. The other fact is that about 80% of HCC occurs in patients with cirrhosis. Now, in the patient who has cirrhosis, because the liver is underlying liver is not normal, resection is not going to be feasible in all patients, because if we do a resection in a patient with cirrhosis, underlying liver be having cirrhosis, they may go into liver failure. And therefore, it is feasible in a small group of patients with cirrhosis, not in all patients. The other problem was that if the tumor was, even though it may not be very big, it was small, but it was centrally located, or if it was multicentric, then it would be impossible to technically do an operation of resection without risking liver decomposition, because you would have to remove a lot of liver because of its location or multicentricity. And we all know that a cirrhotic liver is a potential bed for forming new tumors in the future, or almost like a pre-malignant condition. And therefore, to really treat the problem, you have to also remove the cirrhotic liver. The one situation where you get a liver cancer or HCC without getting too much of, without cirrhosis, is hepatitis B. And that is something that we see once in a while. Now, what's the rationale for doing a transplant in for HCC? Even though the HCC may be small, it may not be big. Because one is you do a total hepatectomy, which can probably the widest surgical margin that you can get when you do clearance surgery for a tumor. It also removes any undetectable small lesions or any other pre-neoplastic type of lesions that are there, or developing lesions that are there. It also removes the potentially tumorigenic liver, cirrhotic liver. And because the patient has decompensated cirrhosis, even a transplant, because the resection, in a resection you leave behind a cirrhotic liver or a remaining liver which is not normal. Here you leave, at the end of transplant, the patient will have a normal functioning liver. Therefore, it will be absolutely well tolerated even by badly decompensated cirrhotic patients. So if transplant is so good, why don't we do transplants for all HCC? Because of, initially people started doing it in the history of transplant. The first 10 transplants that were done in the world, 8 out of them were for kids who had very advanced stage or very large tumors. We realized that these patients had recurrences and there is risk of that operation itself. So that is, these are two reasons why we don't do transplants for all HCCs. So the risk of the surgery itself and the risk of recurrence because of immunosuppression itself. When the tumors were large, we realized that the recurrence risk was more than 50% over 5 years, which is not something that we wanted. And therefore, we realized that if we restrict our transplants to tumors that are not so big, we got excellent results. So this was first realized and published in 1996 by Mazzapiro from Italy, which is called as Milan criteria. So what we realized that if we do transplants for tumors that are less than 5 centimeters, single tumor, or if there are more than one tumor, up to 3 tumors, and all of them were less than 3 centimeters each, and there were no invasion of the portal vein or hepatic veins, and there was no extra hepatic disease, we got excellent success rates. So we had disease-free survival of 83%, which was the success rate of transplant at that time. But since 1996, we have got better imaging. We don't do biopsies anymore. Liver transplant has become safer. We have better loco-regional treatments. We have, and we still don't have any curative chemotherapy. So in view of all this, we thought that maybe 5 centimeters is not probably a good cutoff. And in 2001, we extended the criteria into what is called as UCSF criteria. So now we accepted patients with up to 6.5 centimeters tumor and a total diameter of less than 8 centimeters when there were more than one tumor. And with this also, we got equivalent results compared to the Milan criteria, which was earlier discussed. So for such patients is when we will offer transplants to such patients with who meet UCSF criteria. Now, there are two types of transplants, as all of us are aware. Cadaveric transplant, when the liver comes from a person who has passed away, and living donor transplant, because the liver has the unique ability to regenerate. Somebody could, one of the family members could give half of their liver. The half liver in both the recipient and the donor will regenerate back to normal size in about 3 weeks' time. But the unfortunately, there are a lot of patients who need a transplant, and therefore there is a waiting list. Now, for a cadaveric liver, you generally have to wait for about a year, depending on what blood group it is. For a living donor transplant, there is no waiting time. You can get it done within a span of 10 to 15 days, or even within 24 hours if it's an emergency case. The organ quality is unpredictable in a cadaveric transplant because it's coming from somebody who has died. But in a living donor transplant, the living donor is thoroughly tested with a lot of detailed testing, including a biopsy if required. And we are sure about the quality of the liver before somebody is accepted as a living donor. But the amount of liver that is required for a successful transplant also depends on the patient's weight. So if there is a person who is very heavy, then a living donor transplant may not be very suitable, because then you'll need a very large right lobe for a successful transplant. In such patients, you could do something like a dual lobe transplant, where two donors donate and one person gets a transplant. But for patients who are sick, for patients who have acute liver failure, and patients who have liver cancer, for these patients, it is better to think of a living donor transplant, because these patients need a transplant soon and they do not have the time for a cadaveric transplant. Now, how is a cadaveric transplant done? So it's fairly simple. A person who has passed away, once their liver is perfused with a special preservative solution, which can preserve the liver for about 6 to 12 hours. This liver is preserved at about 4 degrees, which is ice temperature. And then it is transported to the hospital where the recipient is. And then we do a few anastomoses with the IVC, with the portal vein and the artery. And then the liver starts working, starts making bile immediately on the operation table itself. There are several reports of large series of cadaveric liver transplants, and currently the outcomes of cadaveric transplants are excellent, with about 85% to 90% success rates. And these studies are with the patients for HCC, and as you can see, we are close to 90% success rate for patients who undergo liver transplant for HCC. Then the second is a living donor transplant, where a part of the liver is donated by one of the family members and is transplanted into the patient, where again we have a few anastomoses, where we join the graft half liver's IVC or hepatic veins to the IVC, then the portal vein, then the artery. So this is a technically a little more demanding operation, because all the blood vessels and everything is about half the size of a cadaveric transplant. You know, one half, one-sided artery, one-sided portal vein and such. Now, there are several studies with the experience of living donor transplant for HCC as well. And we are very close to 95% success rate, disease-free survival with living donor transplant for HCC. So we are doing really well there. So in summary, I would say that liver transplant is currently the best curative option for cirrhotic patients with HCC within the UCSF criteria we discussed. Patients beyond UCSF criteria, they can still be considered for transplant provided they are subjected to loco-regional therapies. Loco-regional therapies such as radiofrequency ablation or transarterial chemoembolization. So if they respond well to such therapies and they after these therapies, they are within UCSF criteria, then these patients also have very good outcomes with the transplant. And patients who have undergone a resection in the past, if they develop a tumor in the liver, then also they can be considered for a transplant. Such a transplant is called a salvage transplant. Unfortunately, out of all patients who undergo resection, only about 50% of them will get a recurrence within the liver. These are the ones who will be suitable for a salvage transplant, but the other 50% will have systemic recurrence, and those will not be suitable for a liver salvage transplant. Thank you very much.
Very nice, very beautiful and very practical. And sir has given very useful insights into the recent advances. And now I invite Dr. Anuradha Murthy ma'am to present her presentation. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. I'm not getting my sorry, my thing is not opening.
Is your presentation open?
I think so. One sec.
You can reopen your presentation and then try screen share.
Just a minute. Yeah, the presentation is open.
Now, I'm please select the option of share screen.
Yeah. I have.
Then you get the option. Okay. No, ma'am, we can see your desktop. Can you please select the presentation? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I'm not getting the option of the
go to slideshow.
Slideshow, yeah, I've got it. Sorry, I am a bit of a Luddite. okay, so thank you very much for those wonderful talks. And at the outset itself, I would like to thank both Dr. Samir and Dr. Ravi for giving me this insight into working so closely with them. And I can say without affectation, these have been one of the most superior teams I have ever encountered. Now, I would like to start with, since the reference has been, do we look at a historic perspective? I certainly think so. And we are living in what is called a modern era, which is post 1950. Now, along the 1990s, this specific entities, pooling of resources, patient cohorts, samples, allowed for clinical network trials, and this visible and less visible intellectual development. Now, long ago, Samir asked me, have you heard of the gnomes? So in 1967, a small group of very dedicated hepatologists started what were gnomes in the 67s, then elves. And you can see there were very small numbers. So 15 numbers, members, then the elves had 16, the gremlins had only 5. And now we know Linnaeus is a little more expanded. And as Megha actually said, there have been specific centers, like we are in the Asia Pacific area, but we must give much of the sort of bowing down to Hans Popper, who set up the Hepatopathology Society in 1990 in USA. Now, Hans Popper was a man who is amazing, or was amazing. And yesterday was his death anniversary. And you can see here, he's holding up a micro photograph, which is now obsolete. So the COVID era has gone. We still have Hans Popper, who died in 88. So from that, we have a very wonderful quote that he's often said, that the best research tool is an HNE slide, which is connected to a brain. Now, let me tell you at the outset, I can't tell you how much both Dr. Mohankar and Dr. Samir, as clinicians, know about the liver pathology. And I think this is a very, very important thing for any person who works on the liver to know the pathology, at least arbitrarily. So there have been these very metaphoric planetary terms that clinicians are from Mars and pathologists from Venus, and pathologists from Mercury and clinicians from Uranus. And we've had lots of fights. We don't seem to have a common language, but through the discussions, I think at least one is understanding the difficulties in this complex area. Now, what we have all agreed upon is that we have to give an accurate, clinically meaningful tumor diagnosis. We have to prognosticate, and we have to understand the tumor etiology. So we've gone through many of these synergistic values, the etiology, cirrhosis versus non-cirrhosis, the radiology has been emphasized, that very often we do not have a biopsy, and the histology is so complex, and we have to understand many things, and the most fundamental being intratumoral heterogeneity, and finally the outcomes. Now, my talk does include biomarkers. They were alluded to, but I would say that alpha fetoprotein, AFPL3, DCP, PIVCA2, these have all been alluded to. Now, we do have some recourse to a liquid biopsy, and we have what is sequencing. Now, this is a paper which I would ask many of our pathologists to read, which is from Clinical Liver Diseases 2020, where they actually talk about the importance of both these trials, the GALLARD as well as the extended BALLARD trial. Now, very occasionally as pathologists, we are given fluids, we examine values. So I think these are few more biomarkers, bilirubin, CEA, and CA19.9. Now, this is one of our archived cases from when we were working in Global Hospital, where the CA19.9 was 22,814. In a benign hepatic cyst. So sometimes you can get these supra elevated levels, and it's in benign backgrounds. So they come sometimes in hepatic cyst adenomas, and you can see them in infarctoid areas. So what are these trials that we are trying to do? when we were, we, you know, when you collaborate, there's gender, age, AFP3, which is all done on the Roche Alexis platform, which we have. Then these elevated AFPs are very important. And I think if one watched Dr. Mohankar's talk, where they are elevated, we automatically know that these are associated with the TP53 mutations and they have poorer outcomes. Then we have VEGF inhibitors. And in the Ballard trial, it is associated with Hep C. So we use bilirubin, albumin, alpha fetoprotein L, again L3, alpha fetoprotein, and DCP. So these do give us some important clues. Now it's a very old onco biomarker, alpha fetoprotein, again started in 1963, often clashed, but like a PSA, it is showing a resurgence. Other ones are glycoproteins, then we have a multi-fucosylated alpha 1, which is rare, then neutrophil alpha lymphocyte ratio, and circulating tumor cells, which do not have much of a value in hepatocellular carcinoma. Now, Dr. Mohankar again alluded to actually liver tumors. Now we have to think out of the organ because it's anatomic, it's functionally complex, and there are many extrahepatic systemic problems. Then we have a very, very advanced WHO classification, which is important. Then we have the nature of the material, which can sometimes include FNACs, true cut, excisions, and explants. Again, as we are just focusing on the explant, I'd like to tell you that there is a GROSS protocol. And on the GROSS bench, every pathologist should really go through the clinical notes to know the loco-regional therapeutic modalities, the radiofrequency ablation, transarterial chemoembolization, and you see these beads, you look at the treatment that has been given, and most of these patients have already had sorafenib. This is a book which is like a bench book for pathologists. It was first brought out by Roddy McSween. And we know Sheila Sherlock and her eyes. These set up actually the GNOME Society. And even as late as this year, he was sort of honored in Glasgow as a great luminary in pathology. Two more things which also are invaluable are tumors of the liver and the digestive system, last 2019. Now in transplants, we have live donors, cadaveric, and there is this acute shortage, so the extended donor criteria. And the goal is actually to always expand the donor pool. Frozen sections can sometimes be done, and ultimately it is this is the one area where a pathologist does have a very integral role in deciding whether it is an acceptable graft or an unacceptable graft. So steatosis greater than 30 is rejected, microsteatosis has no importance. And we have, of course, some amount of the hepatitis. We don't usually like to take it, but this is one area. Fibrosis should be much less than 2. Non-specific inflammation is allowed. Necrosis less than 10% is allowed, and malignancy, of course, not. So we just go through some of the drugs that may cause microsteatosis, and macrosteatosis is in the form of the lipids. So what is the important caution for both pathologists and the referring surgeon is that we should use fresh biopsies. Air drying diminishes the fat. They should not be placed on gauze because the fat is leached out, and saline leads to over-interpretation. And this is one thing which I must thank Dr. Mohankar, because this is what he actually pointed out in the room, always please note that the surgeon usually comes to check this because he wants to be sure that he's taking a proper graft, because it is a very, very critical, crucial kind of a test. So now, how do we graft these explants? We actually should be looking at the image. Then we slice in the axial plane. We locate the tumor, either single or whatever number of lesions. We look at the location, the segment, the necrosis. Necrosis becomes very important because to see viable tissue, you need to include at least viable tissue. Otherwise, you'll be just seeing necrotic tumor, especially after they have been treated. Then you look at the margins and finally the response and the staging. There is no perfect staging. So what we talk about is the novel staging. So we have this sort of systemic kind of genomic clinical complex disease. We always look at the background of the cirrhosis, and then finally we try to predict recurrence. So there is a 5-gene score, which is the latest on the block. And then we have something which is all pathologists are very eager to look at, which is called next generation IHC. So I've taken some of these images from MSKCC, and I'll just give you illustrative problems. Now I'm attending a current MSKCC talk where it was very interesting that they say we are forming centers of excellence, which is like, I will say global is definitely a center of excellence. So we are the surgeons and the followers and the pathologists are the actual keepers of the material. So every specimen that is an explant has to be photographed, has to be given a documentation, has to be registered, and has to be used as a repository. We are custodians of this tissue. So what they are doing in America is saying, if you call yourself a center of excellence, then you have these teaching symposia. The person who is supposed to be the highest sort of authority should send out a list of, give me a focal nodular hyperplasia, give me this material. And from your repository, you are supposed to provide him this so that he can look, review, and see whether you have diagnosed it correctly. So I think very early on, both Dr. Mohanka and Dr. Samir had started and incorporated a first opinion and a second opinion. So you benchmark, you give the patient the best option, and second opinions are very useful. This is a hepatic adenoma. We don't have too many of these in our files, but we know that they are classified and we have to do a beta-catenin in these. And we can submit them to NGS. They do have a little different prognosis. And I do have one cause that sometimes we don't have a pre-biopsy material in HCC, but very occasionally there have been some sort of there have been gray zones, both in whether it is well differentiated versus dysplastic, whether it is a cirrhotic, diffuse cirrhosis like hepatocellular carcinoma, which are very rare. Then we have occasionally 3 cases in our files of a fibrolamellar variant, which is again of a very different, it becomes very imperative for a pathologist to know these varieties of tumors. They have to be able to perform IHC, they have to be able to reproduce the IHC. So I think where we sometimes have gone wrong is we've removed tumors for angiomyofibromas, we've had angiomyolipomas, we've had some benign cases. Now the new WHO fascicle has expanded the list. And this is something which is a comprehensive sub tumor list, which I want to just discuss because they've added this in the WHO 2019, which is a carcinosarcoma chromophobe hepatocellular. And this has a telomere pathway. Then this serotomimetic, which I showed you, clear cell, because this can also mimic renal cell, combined hepatocellular and cholangiocarcinoma, which have a worse prognosis. And then we have neuroendocrine, fibrolamellar. Then we have this sort of GCFP hepatocellular, HCC with giant cells, lymphocytic-rich hepatocellular carcinomas, myxoid hepatocellular, sarcomatous, squamous, steatohepatic hepatocellular carcinoma, and the transitional, which occurs in children, which has a very poor prognosis. So I think what happens is the pathologist has to be aware, because he has to do what is called a kind of a mental exercise, where he uses practical immunohistochemistry, which as we know is a major ancillary tool that we have. So you distinguish primary, secondary, because you can have hepatoid carcinomas. So this distinction becomes panel driven. And of course, we have now what is called second generation IHC. So early on, we have actually a classification of pathologists. And in the classification of pathologists, we have those who are our eternal immuno-optimists, those who are immuno-pessimists, and those who are actually realists. So in this type of classification, we have to take garden variety and non-garden variety hepatocellular carcinomas, distinguish them from metastasis, and then we have this big group, which I think all of us have sort of fallen into, which is the neuroendocrine group. And neuroendocrine, always a serum chromogranin is asked for. And algorithmically, you can separate all these neuroendocrine, midgut, foregut, whether they are primary, whether they're from the lung. So it does become very imperative for the pathologist to try to classify neuroendocrine tumors. And finally, we have one area that this application of these immunostains, they really independent method, but histopathology is so complicated because the tumor subtypes are so complicated and it is such a heterogenic group, this HCC, that finally we have to transform it from an art to a science. And for that, I think there are, you know, lots of a pathologist really knows that he has got a limitation. So when there is a lot of discrepancy between HNE, additional studies have to be performed. And I think it's always useful to ask for help. So now we have now become quite an interesting tribe of the pathologists. We've got out of the paraffin curtain. We have become a physician. We also want to treat the patient. We are pathologists and we have to use the art and the science. And finally, we're also business people because it's all very expensive to carry out these very expensive both treatments, investigations, and finally outcomes. Right now, the hot topic is whether we use checkpoints in patients who have not responded. And as a laboratory, we offer PD-L1, MSI, all these checkpoint inhibitors. Now, this is again a paper from Mayo Clinic, where he on the stamp we have Mr. James Allison, who won the Nobel Prize for Immunotherapy. The next thing in our armamentarium, which again I have to thank Samir for, is that we started a kind of a discussion with what is called a whole slide imaging process. And I must say, we are one of the earliest to embrace this technology. And throughout the lockdown, it has helped us no small amount. And this is digital pathology. Now, this digital pathology allows the pathologist to view the slide at any time, any place, any space. But more importantly, it has improved accuracy. It has improved synoptic reporting. It has improved quality and has permitted many eyes to watch a quality process. So laboratory management has become lean. It has become certainly very, very superior. And our very dynamic pathologist and head, Dr. Kirti Chadda, had presented our work in the liver symposium. And this was just before the lockdown. So from 2018, we've been archiving many of these cases. And what this digital pathology system, it follows acquisition, retrieval, storage, manipulation, and sharing. It gives you the mischief area. It allows you to annotate, and it improves patient care. So just like radiology, I think pathology is moving in that direction of digitalizing, sharing, and growing to a community sort of focus. So we can form repositories, and these repositories allow anybody to actually train as well as hold on to the material we have. And the material we have is actually gold, because if you talk about 430 cases, transplants of this, I mean, how many centers have this? So we have the tissues, we have the blocks. So it becomes very imperative to try both repositories as well as, we can use it for a lot of research areas. So I end by actually concluding that conventional histopathology is definitely the gold standard. 100 years later, pathologists have teamed up with hardware and software engineers to exploit the remarkable developments to bridge traditional, global, plus omic, plus analysis gaps. And this is an ending with actually, again, a homage, a very sobering homage to Dr. Hans Popper, who actually believed and kept this book, this photograph of Sir Francis Bacon on his table of what is good and evil. And this was actually counsel, civil, and moral dilemmas. And I must say, if in all honesty, without being sycophantish, both every part of the transplant team is extremely ethical. They have looked at the interests, and as Samir said, it's not been an easy task to actually maintain the highest standard, and it's not easy to get such excellent results. And many, many thanks for this opportunity, Megha and Metropolis. Thank you. And really, we have to unlock our creativity.
Thank you, ma'am, for this beautiful presentation with history of liver transplants. Now it's time to proceed with question and answer session. So I request all the panelists to come on. So our first question is common in today's pandemic is how safe it is for a patient to undergo liver transplant during pandemic, and what kind of extra precautions we need to take. So this is open for all.
Ravi, would you like to take up that question?
Sure. So it's actually quite safe to undergo a transplant during the pandemic. The hospitals where transplants are being done, They have segregated, just like our hospital, we have segregated the non-COVID and COVID facilities, including staff, including lifts. Everything is separate. And we have been successfully doing transplants for patients even in the last 1 year. Now, the other thing is that actually the COVID infection doesn't affect transplant patients as much as it does the regular people. Why? Because they are already on immunosuppression. So they don't get as bad a cytokine storm as a normal person gets, you know, because their immune system is slightly suppressed with the medicine. So it's absolutely safe. Although we do have restrictions on accepting a liver from somebody who is infected with COVID themselves. So we can't do that. Or if a recipient has COVID, active COVID at that time, then at that time they can't have a transplant. Other than that, it's absolutely fine and safe to do it.
Thank you, sir. The second question is for Murthy ma'am. It's what special services Metropolis has for transplant patients.
Ma'am
has already covered a few of the points.
Yeah, we start from actually the entire pre-transplant. So we have developed a very complex, again, with the clinicians' inputs. So we have developed pre-transplant, post-transplant packages, and both for the recipient and the donor. Also, in liver, we don't use HLA so much, but our services for HLA are all available. And as a protocol, serum and blood is collected. So if we need to go back, we can do anything, even reactions that may occur, we may go back to them. So we are able to provide very robust HLA services. Then we have definitely worked so closely over these years that we have developed, I mean, we are still general surgical pathologists, but we have developed a very, very accurate means to sometimes help. So I think what we have is a very expanded biopsy panel of IHC. We are doing checkpoint analysis. We have PD-L1, we have actually got very nice toxic workup. So I think we can monitor a fair amount. And it would not be, you know, just boastful to say, I think we've worked very closely to provide good patient care. And because of the structure and the function, we can provide home services to many of these patients. Thank you. And actually now, one more thing, Megha, we are coming out with packages and we will disseminate and we will actually do our analysis between you and the rest of the team to actually give a little direction and results.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Our next question is, how successful is pediatric liver transplant? This was not covered, no?
Yeah, so it's actually very successful. The pediatric liver transplants are sometimes have results which are even more better than the overall or the adult transplants, because for them there are, so although there are certain complications that are more likely in pediatric transplants, for example, hepatic artery thrombosis, portal vein thrombosis, because these kids have smaller diameter vessels and they have low flow vessels, therefore they are more likely to have these technical problems. But once they overcome that period where technical complications are surpassed, after that they do extremely well. And as you can understand, these patients' transplants, they are successful like 40, 50, 70 years. So and also there have been some studies which shows that over the long term, 20% of the kids can develop tolerance. So they will not even require immunosuppression in the long term, although that is currently not something that we can recommend clinically. But there is some evidence to say that about 20% of kids will in the long term not require immunosuppression. So kids do extremely well. Pediatric transplants are very successful.
Thank you, sir. Then the next question is, what is the incidence of de novo cancer after after liver transplant?
So in the West, the most common cancers reported are skin cancer and PTLD, that is post-transplant lymphoproliferative diseases. And between the two, the incidence is around 5% to 7%. But fortunately, for some reason in India, we just don't see either of these.
Yeah,
but it is uncommon. Like, it's not as often as they say in the West. So therefore, for us, the chances of de novo cancers in India is not reported, and it is not even really known, but it is low. That's what we know, because we don't get skin cancers and we don't get PTLDs as much. What do you think, ma'am? Have you seen a lot of PTLDs?
Megha, in global, Dr. Bharat Shah has had 3 cases. Yeah. And renal transplant, we have had 1 case in global also. Yeah.
So even that is very low, ma'am, because there the PTLD rates are also around 5% in the West. So we are doing something right, or we are susceptibility is less, but we are seeing, and skin cancers like practically nil.
I think there has to be a high index of suspicion.
Yes.
And sometimes in checkpoint, in when we use checkpoint inhibitors, you can get a simulation of ulcerative colitis. Mm. So these little points, I think, are coming in collaboration.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So the last question is for Samisa, sir. What are the chances of someone with HCV infection developing cirrhosis or liver cancer?
So HCV, if it is treated early, then you can prevent progression. But if, unfortunately, by the time the patient presents to you, already the patient has become cirrhotic, then even when you clear the hepatitis C virus, because the patient has become cirrhotic, the tendency for hepatocellular carcinoma remains. So I think that is something which we will need to follow up these patients even after we have cleared the C virus, just like any other patient with cirrhosis. We need to keep on. The other important thing which we have realized now is both hepatitis B and C, we may be able to control the virus or cure the virus, but many of these patients have associated metabolic syndrome. So the virus is cleared or virus is controlled, but then the patient may develop hepatocellular carcinoma because there is an underlying fatty liver disease. So further deterioration, progression to cirrhosis and hepatocellular carcinoma continues despite successful control of hepatitis B and C viruses. I think so it's very important to realize that even though you may control or cure the virus, if there is an additional metabolic syndrome and fatty liver inside, that can progress.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question. So it's please let us know if any experience with transplant cytology. Is frozen and histopath completely correlated? So, ma'am,
we don't. It's a very difficult question to answer because we don't post transplant. We have actually never had a recurrence. I think Ravi will be able to also answer that. So far, I don't remember seeing the transplant having cancer.
So we have had some recurrences, ma'am, post-transplant. They have been generally extrahepatic. I don't know a number, but it will be few. A few patients we have had recurrences.
I don't remember an explant having it in the liver.
And this is Samisha was saying something.
Or maybe, as you say,
Yeah. Sir, you are muted.
So no, please unmute.
Yeah. No, I was saying that post-transplant recurrence, by and large, we don't biopsy. And so Anuradha would not get the samples to assess because usually it would stop at the clinical level. We know that the patient had transplantation for a malignancy. Mm-hmm. And now because it has recurred, we would usually treat it and not biopsy. Yeah.
Okay. Hope this has answered your queries. So our speakers have given very nice comprehensive overview of the neoplastic and non-neoplastic diseases. And ma'am has added historical perspective to it and also included the advances also. So now it's time to conclude the session. And I would like to thank all the speakers for giving us the very beautifully crafted talk. And I would like to thank all the viewers also and for sparing their time and joining us. So stay safe and stay healthy. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.